Here's a weird looking problem. Let W be the span of 1, T in C, negative 1, 2. And the goal is to find an orthonormal basis for W. Boy, this is kind of a strange problem. All right, let's get our bearings here. What is C, negative 1, 2? That's a vector space. In particular, it's a function space. The elements or vectors in here are functions, not just any old functions, functions that are continuous on this closed interval from negative 1 to 2, which includes, you know, for example, all polynomials. It includes cosine and sine. It includes e to the t. It includes e to the negative t, e to any power times t, e to the t squared. There's infinitely many functions in here. And in fact, this is an infinite dimensional vector space. It has no finite basis. W, however, is the span of two quote-unquote vectors, two functions that, well, these are not scalar multiples of each other. They are linearly independent functions. W is going to be a two-dimensional subspace of this. One, what is that? That's the constant function. Graph is a horizontal line. T, that's the function T. Graph is a line through the origin with a slope of 1. But we're thinking of these functions as being elements of a function space. Each function is one point or one vector or one element of the function space. Find an orthonormal basis for W. Why are we doing this? Why would we care? Because it's relevant for Fourier series, and Fourier series are relevant for partial differential equations, which we do want to learn a little bit about here in our last week of class. There's a ton of depth you could go into partial differential equations. We're just trying to get the basic idea of them. You got to learn about this kind of thing to understand that. How do you find an orthonormal basis for an ordinary kind of subspace, like a plane in R3? Given a basis, you can always find an orthonormal basis by the gram-schmidt process and also normalizing your vectors. Oh, gram-schmidt process. Oh, well, that's for two-dimensional subspace, that's not too hard. Do orthogonal projections, just like on the exam, except we're doing them with functions now. And we're doing it, instead of with dot products, with something called an inner product. In fact, when I say that I'm after an orthonormal basis for a subspace of a function space, there's got to be some inner product in the background. The idea of an inner product generalizes the idea of a dot product. And here it's a little funny. We use multivariable calculus vector notation, but this is not a vector. This is effectively the weird symbol for the dot product in this context. This is analogous to f dot g. But you don't say f dot g. You say the inner product of f and g. This is not a vector in this context. And how do you find the value of this inner product? It's defined using an integral. Why? Because that's useful. That's why. Are there other ways to define the inner product? Yeah, there are actually. There's infinitely many different inner products you could define. But the one that's most useful, or at least proportional to one that's most useful, is to integrate the product of f and g over the interval that we're considering here, negative 1 to 2. So the negative 1 and the 2 come from the particular vector space that I'm considering. Why did I pick this vector space? Because I just felt like it. That's why. I could have picked any interval here from A to B, and then I'd integrate from A to B. It would be a different vector space. It would be a different inner product, but they're all very similar kinds of examples. The interval does affect what the answer is because it affects this inner product. So what do I want to do with this? I'd like to find the orthogonal projection of, say, that vector, t, that function, onto the subspace spanned by this one, 1. Let's give this a name. Let's call it h of t, maybe, h of t. I don't want to use F or G because I'm already using those. Maybe I should call this one 1 of T. Well, how about I? Would that be confusing to call it I too? J of t. Okay, J of t is the constant function one. I'd like to find the orthogonal projection. I could call it H hat of t. I could use projection symbolism. The orthogonal projection of H onto the subspace spanned by J of t. Maybe I'll call it V, where V is the subspace spanned by J of t, which is just the constant function one, which means V is all constant functions. That's kind of weird to think of, because they're all scalar multiples of one. What in the world are we doing here? I'll come back to it. What's the formula for this, and what does it mean? The formula is completely analogous to the formula with ordinary vectors and ordinary dot products. What's analogous to H dot J? It's the inner product of H with J. Divide by what's analogous to J dot J, the inner product of J with itself. Times the vector itself times J. That's the formula for this orthogonal projection. Completely analogous to the ordinary one, except we're using functions for vectors and inner products for dot products. But to compute these inner products, oh, I got to do some integrals. Well, it's not too hard in this case. Inner product of J with itself, J is the constant function of one. I'm integrating one times one from negative one to two. That's three. All right, I'd get t and evaluate t from negative one to two. Two minus negative one is three. The area under a horizontal line with height one from negative one to two is three. What about the inner product of h with j? T with one, I got to integrate t times one from negative one to two. Get t squared over 2 from negative 1 to 2. That'll be 4 over 2 minus 1 over 2. 3 halves, if I haven't made a mistake. Just like dot products give you numbers, the dot product of two vectors is a number. The inner product of two functions is a number. Plug those numbers up here, and what am I going to get? 3 halves over 3 times the constant function of 1. Now, that it's a constant function of 1 for my example, but I could have done an example where it's not a constant function. Ultimately simplifying to the constant function 1 half. The orthogonal projection of H onto the subspace spanned by J. Oh, it's got to be a multiple of J. It's got to be a constant function. Again, that's a 1 there because that's a 1 there. In general, this doesn't have to be a constant function, but for this example, it is. This one's got to be a constant function as well. It's not representing the number 1 half. It's representing the function 1 half, constant function. What have I really done here? What does this mean? Can we visualize this? Yeah, though it's tricky. One way to visualize it is to imagine that this plane is W, the two-dimensional subspace of the infinite dimensional space there. That is the span of 1 and t. And where is 1 in this picture and where is t? I don't know. It's meant to be an abstract picture. Now, it's tempting to put 1 on the horizontal axis. And no, it doesn't. You could. But maybe that's misleading. I'll just pretend 1 is right there. Just because it's it's a picture by analogy. It's not meant to be literal. And I'll pretend, oh, T is right here. I drew them as dots. I could also, if I want, draw them as arrows. Does that mean functions are arrows? Not typically, but I guess I'm imagining that to be the case here. And I'm projecting T onto the subspace spanned by one, this quote unquote line consisting of infinitely many functions, including the zero function, because the origin is meant to be the zero function. That's for sure. All the constant functions in W are along this line. And I've just found the orthogonal projection. So this is H of T. I've just found H hat of T to be right there. That's 1/2 effectively. And I kind of drew it, you might say, almost semi-accurately, because it looks like this is almost close to half the distance of this one. I didn't mean to do that. That was just an accident. And you don't have to try to draw it accurately. I'm after an orthonormal basis. I haven't completed the gram-schmidt process yet. I need to figure out this vector right there. And then I need to normalize as well. I'm not done. What's that vector? So one is J of T. There's H hat. By analogy, just like you did on the exam, I want this vector plus H hat to equal H. So that vector right there better be H of T minus H hat of T. In other words, it's not a constant function, it's T minus 1/2. So the two functions, one and this function, are orthogonal in this subspace. They're perpendicular. They're not necessarily normalized yet, though. I want an orthonormal basis. I have to divide them by their lengths. What is their length? I won't do the calculation, but let me just tell you the idea. The length of a function, or norm of a function, K of T, let me call it. There's the notation for the norm or length of the function, is the square root of the inner product of K of T with itself. Completely analogous to how the length of a vector, an ordinary vector, is the square root of the dot product of the vector with itself. I won't do the computation there for this example, but this is the quantity you'd have to divide them by. You'd have to find the norm of this function by doing this calculation, divide it by its norm. I'd have to do the same thing with the original function J, and that would give me an orthonormal basis. Why? Again, it's Fourier series and partial differential equations. Is there another way to visualize this? Yes, but I think for the sake of time, I'm not going to go into it. You can try to visualize what's going on here in terms of the graphs of the original functions, ordinary graphs. I'm not doing that here. I'm visualizing it by analogy. Don't take this picture too literally. It's a picture by analogy. But it can be helpful to imagine things this way.